أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. صلى الله عليك يا سيدي يا مولاي يا أبا السلام على الحسين. We send our condolences to Abi Abdullah al-Hussein, the martyred one in Karbala, the slaughtered, the thirsty. السلام على أولاد الحسين. We send our grievances and our condolences to the children of Imam Hussein عليه السلام.
السلام على
Send our condolences to the companions of Abi Abdullah al-Hussein.
As-salamu ala al-ladhina qutilu wa jahadu ma'a al-Hussein wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Qala Allahu jalla wa ala في محكم كتابه الكريم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. من كان يريد العزة فلله العزة جميعا. إليه يصعد الكلم الطيب والعمل الصالح يرفعه والذين يمكرون السيئات لهم عذاب شديد ومكر أولئك يبور. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, whoever desires honor through power, then to Allah belongs all honor, and to Him ascends good speech, and righteous work raises it. But those who plot evil deeds will have a severe punishment, and the plotting of those will perish. For the love of Imam Hussein, for the love of the martyred one, the thirsty, in Karbala, give me Allah salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
And a second salawat for the love of his mother, Fatima al-Zahra, Sayyidati Nisa al-Alameen, the one who, even though she may have not witnessed the tragedy of Karbala physically, but spiritually, she witnessed the tragedy of Karbala. So for her love, sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And a third salawat for the love of our awaited Imam, إمام المهدي عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
السلام عليكم dear brothers and sisters in Islam ورحمة الله وبركاته. Tonight we gather here, brothers and sisters, not only to mourn and to weep and to cry and to beat our chest about Imam Hussein. We are all gathered here specifically and more importantly to remind ourselves of the principles that were upheld in Karbala by Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam. We are gathered here, brothers and sisters, to remind ourselves of our responsibilities and our duties toward Imam Hussein and toward this holy divine message. This holy divine message began with Adam, with prophethood, and it continued through Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And from the institution of prophethood, it was transferred to imamate, to the wilayat of Ali ibn Abi Talib, when the Holy Prophet raised the hand of Imam Ali and Ghadir Khum, and he said, "Man kuntu mawlah, fahada Aliun mawlah." And this was later confirmed, the imamate of Ahlul Bayt was later confirmed, when the Holy Prophet completed his message on that day, and the ayah came down, الْيَوْمُ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. After that, the Holy Prophet, he left us two precious things, and his last will, Hajjat al-Wada', in front of 70,000 people, he told them, what did he tell them? He told them, "I leave to you two precious things. I leave to you the Holy Quran and the Holy Household. And these two things will never separate until they reach me to the pond of Kawthar." So let me ask you a question, brothers and sisters. Did they hold on to these two weighty things after the Holy Prophet? Or did they go and choose their own leaders on earth? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we mentioned in Eid al-Ghadir that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who has the right to choose his leaders on earth. The human being doesn't have a choice. It's not up to him. It's not up to me and you. It's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's up to us to follow him. So Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, he uprised for universal principles. He uprised for justice. He uprised for equality. He uprised for the freedom of all human beings. Doesn't matter if he's white or if he's black or if he's Asian or Middle Eastern. Imam Hussein did not just uprise, he did not uprise for the Arabs, even though most of the ones that were part of his army were Arabs. There was also non-Arabs with Imam Hussein. So Imam Hussein uprised for everyone. And his divine message was the same message that was prescribed to the previous prophets. And tonight, we are going to speak about, inshallah, in these 10 nights, about qualities that we can apply in our daily lives, qualities that Imam Hussein and Ahlul Bayt embodied. Because as you know, that the Ahlul Bayt, alayhimu salatu wassalam, they are the complete embodiment and personification of the Holy Quran. Wherever the Ahlul Bayt go, the Quran is with them, because they are the Quran. And Karbala, the tragedy of Karbala, the whole purpose of the tragedy of Karbala is what? To preserve the Holy Quran. If it was not for Karbala, if it was not for Imam Hussein, then we would not have salah today. We would not have fasting today. We would not have hajj today. We would not have anything today if it was not for Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. I'm very honored to be amongst you, and I thank Imam Sadiq Center for inviting me here. And we are going to tackle some very important issues in these 10 nights. So I'm very humbled and honored to be your servant, inshallah. With that note, give me Allah salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Tonight's subject is going to be about self-confidence. Because Imam al-Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, he was the complete embodiment of self-confidence in Karbala. Imagine, put yourself in the shoes of Imam Hussein. A group of 72 against a group of 30,000. We say, Ya laytana kunna ma'akum sayyidi, fanafuza fawzan azeema. But if we were only 72 against 30,000, would we still stick to our word? Inshallah. When we say, Ya laytana kunna ma'akum sayyidi, fanafuza fawzan azeema, if we did not have a chance to join Imam Hussein, then we will have a chance to join Imam al-Mahdi. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Why is self-confidence important? Why do we need self-confidence these days? In order for us to achieve any kind of success, we need to have self-confidence. How do we build this self-confidence? We are first going to speak about the importance of self-confidence. But the opposite to self-confidence is what? The lack of self-confidence. A lack of self-confidence in ourselves will result in the failure of every facet in our life. Whether it be in education, whether it be in the career, whether it be in our daily lives, if we don't have any confidence, confidence is not just walking straight with your chest out and walking like you're a macho man or you got big muscles or, you know, you're wearing nice clothes. That's not self-confidence. You're acting like you're self-confident. But really deep down inside, when you get hit with a test or with a tribulation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you become weak. You lose that confidence because it's really not there. It's just an act. And I don't agree with the saying, fake it till you make it. I don't agree with that. Because if you are a true believer, you will not have to act. You will not have to fake it. Because you will, inshallah, will reach that solution. I'm not going to give you that solution. I'm going to hold it. So a lack of self-confidence, with this lack of self-confidence, you cannot function in a society. No one will listen to your words. Your words will not have any value. So in our analysis, we will seek to understand the root of attaining an unshakable confidence in ourselves. And this unshakable confidence is the confidence that I'm not talking about the confidence that Michael Jordan had when he would go and shake up his players to go and dunk the basketball rim. This is of a higher confidence. This is the confidence of Imam Ali in Khaybar. This is the confidence of when Imam Ali fought Amr ibn Wadd al-Amri in Al-Khandaq. They came in and asked him, "Oh Imam, how did you defeat Amr ibn Wadd al-Amri?" This man, Amr ibn Wadd, he was so tall that when he would stand, when he would sit on the horse, his legs will trample on the ground. That's how tall he was. They asked Imam Ali, and by the way, the Prophet asked the companions and those that were with Imam, with the Prophet asked them three times, which one of you would go and fight? And of course, it was no other than Ali ibn Abi Talib, who stood up every single time. And he stood up the first time, the second time, and the third time. So the companions, after the battle, they came to Imam Ali, and they told him, "Oh Imam, how did you beat Amr ibn Wadd? How did you defeat him?" He said, First, I had confidence in myself. And two, I had confidence in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's two against one, and I knocked him down. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So a lack of self-confidence in ourselves can result in failure in every facet in our life. There are three elements that causes the lack of self-confidence. The first one is fear. The second one is doubt. And the third one is relying on others, depending on others. Let's go to the first one, which is fear. When we fear something, what happens? We give that fear power over us. That fear, what does it do to us? It paralyzes us because we're scared, we're afraid. We don't want to do that thing, we don't want to go to that place, we don't want to talk to that person, we don't want to we don't want to go somewhere because we fear that place, or we don't want to embark on a business opportunity because we're afraid. And by the way, when we are going to come to the solution, this self-confidence, it will increase our confidence in everything that we do. In a business opportunity, when going and asking for the hand of your spouse, inshallah, you have to be confident. And the woman also has to be confident. So, the first cause of the problem, the lack of self-confidence, is fear. We're afraid. The second one is doubt. Because when we doubt ourselves, we are doubting our capabilities. We don't know ourselves. And when we doubt our capabilities, we don't know what we have. And when we don't know what our tools are, we don't know what to use, when to use them, we doubt ourselves. The third cause of the lack of self-confidence, which is relying on others. You find sometimes, you know, when you go and you ask your friends or you ask anyone, you know, on the street, you know, how's it going? You know, how's life? You know, how's school? How's everything? You know, and if it's raining outside, you know, all of a sudden, if he was happy, he'll have a bad mood. Oh man, I'm having such a bad day. You know, it's raining, the thunderstorm outside, tornado. You know, all of a sudden, his mood changes. His mood goes with the wind. Goes with the weather. Or if someone comes and he, you know, gives him a bad compliment or puts him down, you know, he takes it, you know, personally. So, therefore this person, he's relying on others, depending on others for his happiness. Now, who is affected? I'm affected, you're affected, the individual is affected. Why? Because he lacks direction and purpose. And what is the purpose of the human being? The purpose of the human being, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create mankind but to worship me. But why? Allah doesn't need our worship. We need Him. Why does He want us to worship Him? Because if we worship Him, we will become happy. Why will we become happy? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show us who we are. And once we know who we are, then that is the solution. The second group of people that are affected is the family. Because if the family lacks direction and purpose, the father isn't going to know his role, the mother isn't going to know her role, the daughter isn't going to know her role, the son isn't going to know his role, and the roles are going to be switched. The mother is going to be the father, and the father is going to be the mother. The father is going to do the cooking. It's okay, you know, to do the cooking. Like that one movie, when Adam Sandler was in that movie, he was, actor, the African-American actor, I forgot his name. He was doing the cooking, and his wife was working. And every time she would come to the house, she would be the one to complain, you know, and he has to take that complaint from her. So we have to know our roles in the family, the father and the mother and so on. The third group of people that is affected is the community. And this is the greatest effect. Because if the individual, at the individual level and at the family level, no one knows their roles, then we will have a society of chaos. Instead of the one who is supposed to become a doctor, he becomes, for example, a garbage man. Instead of the garbage man, you know, becoming garbage man, he becomes the head of office in a government. So everyone has to know their purpose. We will have a society that will be a chaotic society. So what are the consequences? If we don't solve this problem on an individual basis, then on an individual basis, you'll be jumping from one thing to the next. You don't know what your purpose in life is. You know, like you'll be jumping from one major to the next. One day you want psychology, the next day you want business, the next day you want communication, the next day you want to be a lawyer. Every single day you want something new. You don't have a purpose. On the family level, if you live with your parents, that's fine. They raised you on the love of Ahlul Bayt and the Prophets and the Quran, that's fine. But when it comes to your personality, brothers and sisters, one day you're going to have to be on your own. And you cannot just rely on your parents. I'm sure our parents will tell us, Ahla wa Sahla, and you can stay with us your whole life if you want to. But there's going to come a day where you're going to have to become independent. And the third level of society, level of people, which is the society. Like we said, if we do not fix this problem, then our society will be in chaos. Now, if we don't solve these causes of, what are the causes of lack of self-confidence? What did we say? Fear, doubt, and relying on others. If we don't solve these problems on the individual, the family, and the social level, then we will fail ultimately as a people. Although, however, brothers and sisters, there is a way out of this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the tools, has given us the examples to follow. So if we don't want to stay in this level of lacking self-confidence, then the only way to get out of this is to rely on no other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the greatest example of self-confidence in Karbala was Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wassalam. Who was he? Imam Hussein was the grandson of the Holy Prophet. And the Prophet said about Imam Hussein, Husseinun minni wa ana min Hussein. Ahabba Allah man ahabba Husseina. Hussein is from me and I am from Hussein. May God love him or her who loves Hussein. And may God curse him who killed Hussein, alayhi salatu wassalam. So Imam Hussein was the complete embodiment of self-confidence in Karbala. And this is who we should learn from when we want to attain this quality of self-confidence. Trust me, brothers and sisters, you don't need to go to the Barnes & Noble self-help section and pick up a book about self-confidence. You have the greatest examples between us. We have Ahlul Bayt, the personification of the Quran. We have jewels, we have treasures. Let us discover these jewels. And if you go and you do your research, brothers and sisters, you will find that those who have written books about self-confidence and how to be successful, you will find that they have taken the information from who? From Islam, from Ahlul Bayt, but they have taken the credit for it. Why do we go? Why should we go to the student when we can go to the teacher? So Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, what is his solution to building the lack of self-confidence to confidence? He says, من ترك الشهوات كان حرا. Whoever leaves his desires will become free. And when we become free, we will have more energy. We will have, what is freedom mean? You know, when we fast, why do we fast? To discipline our body parts. You know, this is one way of strengthening our willpower and confidence, is by fasting. Because when we fast, we shatter all the obstacles in our way. We discipline ourselves, we discipline our body parts. Subconsciously, what does this mean? That means that we're telling our body parts that we control you, you don't control us. I control my stomach doesn't control me. I control my tongue, because when we fast, we don't only fast from eating, we fast from backbiting, from lying, from our ears, from listening, you know, to the haram. We fast from these things, so we discipline ourselves. So when we become free, it basically means that we become in control of ourselves. And this is why Imam Ali, he says, من عرف نفسه عرف ربه. Whoever knows himself knows God. And what does Imam Salih alayhi salatu wasalam say? ما نقر الله من ذل المعاصي إلى عز التقوى إلا أغناه من غير مال وعزه من غير عشيرة وآنسه من غير بشر. If we want to reach closeness and proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should increase our taqwa, our piety. And once we do this, then this will strengthen our willpower, and this will defeat the causes of the lack of self-confidence, which is fear. Number one is fear. We won't fear anyone. If we don't want to be fearful of anything, we should fear only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to his holy prophet, and the holy prophet says that whoever fears God will make everything fear him. But whoever doesn't fear God, he will make him fear everything. So this is why we should fear Allah. Now there are different levels of fear, and we will conclude. The best kind of fear, which is not fear, it's not fear. The opposite to fear is what? Love. And this is when we come to Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, when he says, مَا عَبَدْتُكَ خَوْفًا مِنْ نَارِكَ وَلَا طَمَعًا فِي جَنَّتِكَ عَبَدْتُكَ لَأَنُّهُ رَأَيْتُكَ أَهْلٌ لِلْعِبَادَةِ. Oh Allah, I do not worship you because of fear of your hellfire. I do not worship you in greediness to your heaven. The reason why I worship you is because I discovered that you are the one who deserves to be worshipped. This is the level that we should be at. So this is what our Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam, they teach us. So the benefits of our obeying our Creator is that we will distinguish these elements and these causes of the lack of self-confidence, which is the fear. If we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we love Him, we won't fear anything. If we put our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will not doubt anything. We will not doubt ourselves. If we put our faith in our iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then eventually we will not depend on others. It's good to depend on others, such as family, good family members. But the main core of relying should be only on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are able to achieve anything in our lives. So if we want to achieve the self-confidence and to strengthen our willpower, we should and we must follow the best examples that were given to us, the representatives of God. What is a practical method that we can follow to build our confidence? And we will conclude. When you go home today, go stand in front of the mirror and ask yourself a basic question. Who am I? How many times do we ask ourselves this question, who am I? When you ask yourself this question, follow these three steps and you will gain self-confidence. The first step is that you should admit that you are weak.